I was asked to talk about outflow resistance, proximal and distal, from Schlemms canal as it relates to surgery. I have no conflict of interest to disclose. Overview. First, I want to talk about the substrate and the location of outflow resistance. Second, about the treatment goals. Third, about canal-based mix. MIG stands for minimally invasive glaucoma surgeries or microincisional glaucoma surgeries. And fourth, adjuvant distal outflow tract dilation. Substrate and location. Where exactly is the outflow resistance? This is a sagittal section through an eye. The cornea is here, iris, sclera, ciliary body, Schlemm's canal, trabecular meshwork, and what you see here is inserted a trabecular meshwork ablation device, the trabectome. Aqueous humor has to enter Schlemm's canal and then drains through aqueous veins through a plexus into the episcleral veins. When you remove the TM, you can see that in advanced glaucoma, here grade 4, this is a grading scale that takes into account the preoperative pressure, the visual field, and also the number of medications, that in advanced glaucoma, there is a bigger pressure drop from TM removal compared to just ocular hypertension. Those patients get a lesser drop. So this is encouraging. This suggests that the worse the glaucoma, the higher the outflow resistance at the level of the trabecular meshwork, and therefore the bigger the pressure drop from removing the meshwork, which you see here ablated with this plasma ablation device. However, one can also observe that after having removed the trabecular meshwork, there can be an additional pressure drop, for instance, after giving nitric oxide. This is a tissue culture model, however, and that used porcine eyes. It's important to have very fresh eyes to actually allow these vessels to react to substances. Dr. Stamer's lab has done a very similar study. In addition to using porcine eyes, they've also used human eyes where they observed a similar effect. So one can conclude there are probably two resistor elements. One is the trabecular meshwork that you see removed here, and there must be another area of outflow resistance downstream of the Schlemm's canal, because if that were not the case, you would expect a pressure of 8 millimeter mercury, the pressure that can be found in the episcleral veins. Okay, so that's the Goldman equation. If you really had eliminated all flow resistance, trabecular meshwork removal surgeries should produce a pressure of 8, because that is the pressure found in episcleral veins. So 8, let's set the bar to 8 here. And surprisingly, in most studies, you can find that almost nobody has this pressure. In this case, you can see one single patient out of 300. At the x-axis, you have a baseline IOP here. And on the y-axis, this is the post-ablation IOP at 1 month. So before eye drops are, before glaucoma medications are started. In other words, somebody with a pressure of 30 is more likely to have a significantly higher pressure than somebody who starts with a low pressure. This is correlated, implying that the worse the glaucoma, the worse the downstream outflow resistance that has to be, well, somewhere here in the area circle. We don't really know the substrate. We don't know what it is. And no other specialty would go ahead and just do a surgery, and then hope for the best without seeing and imaging the structure that you're trying to treat. This is here a picture from interventional cardiology. Of course, you do a cardiogram, you take a look at with radiodense material to see where there is the blockage, and if you've identified the blockage, you can insert a stent that then allows better flow. So what tests are there that can assess the outflow or the outflow system structurally? There is the canalogram where dyes are injected, and one can see that in this eye, this is a porcine eye looking in the camera, it's turned sideways, but there's a nasal ablation that occurred here. This is the eye before and after the trabecular meshwork ablation. You can see that this fills faster, and yet although there's only an ablation nasally, there is actually a filling that's circumferential. One can express this with little macro pixels that tell you how much flow there is in what area and how quickly the intensity, for instance, increases. One can use the SDOCT to look at living tissue and demonstrate vasoreactivity. One can constrict these outflow tract vessels and dilate them. How does this work? Well, they're really commercial versions of the same SDOCT that's used to diagnose glaucoma by looking at the optic nerve head. But one can set this to the anterior segment and then subtract away the sclera. So that's how this can be visualized in a nutshell. And then one can use very high resolution ribbon scanning confocal. That, however, only works once the tissue is fixed and one has to apply a clearing protocol to make it transparent. Otherwise, with an optical microscope, one cannot see through the opaque sclera, obviously. And one has to stain the pathways. This here is a collector channel. This is a human eye. One can see how long these collector channels stretch out from Schlemms canal, seen here in yellow, all the way into the draining plexus. So there is, of course, a problem with all these tests. This one is invasive. This is a true function test. This could be done on a patient. One could test, for instance, where these vessels dilate, but what does that tell you? Well, I guess one can diagnose a disease or a non-reactivity of vessels. And this here, of course, is not something that can be done in living eyes, so it's only it really only works for biopsies, enucleated eyes, unfortunately. So we're stuck not really being able to have a test to see whether there is a distal outflow resistance. That's a dilemma. An even bigger problem in this context is that if you had a dye that you could get into a patient's anterior chamber to see whether there is flow or none, the problem is you could not really use this to distinguish between an outflow barrier at the level of the trabecular meshwork or at the distal outflow site. If there is no outflow problem at the level of the trabecular meshwork, as suggested here by this dotted line, fluorescein should flow into the distal outflow system, and you could see then all these lovely vessels that participate in conventional outflow. So that would work with healthy trabecular meshwork, but you have now a glaucoma patient in extreme form, the trabecular meshwork is very impermeable. This here is this red line is basically the same line here. If that eye had a non-permeable trabecular meshwork or a very poorly permeable, The dye could not exit the anterior chamber, or at least not efficiently, and one could not study the flow speeds and the flow distribution in any meaningful way. One could not distinguish between a blockage or reduced outflow at the level of a trabecular meshwork or a reduced outflow and increased resistance somewhere in the collector channels or in slightly anterior to them, maybe at the level of the orifices where there can be little valves, as Murray Johnston described, or it could be somewhere else. It could be at the point where the collector channels enter the episcleral veins, for instance. We just don't know. So what's the solution to that? Here again, let's say this is our trabecular meshwork. One can do all sorts with this strainer. One can blast it with SRT. That it works actually quite effectively if there is a increased resistance at the level of the trabecular meshwork. For instance, in primary open-angle glaucoma, in pigmentary glaucoma, in steroid-induced glaucoma, it works quite well. Or it could be a blockage further downstream. Could you use SLT to test for a functioning distal outflow system? Well, again, you really can't. You don't know the reason for not getting a pressure drop, for instance. If the laser made the trabecular meshwork more permeable, that's fine. You would expect the pressure to drop, except you wouldn't expect it to drop if there were a distal outflow resistance in addition to the trabecular meshwork level that you've just treated. And if you don't get any effect, you don't know whether the trabecular meshwork is simply non-responsive for some reason. This surely can happen. Or again, whether this is a blockage for downstream. So what do you do? Throw the, get a new sink if the old one is broken. So that would be a very practical approach for this one here. You would probably just replace the pipe, but as a more graphic explanation, one could do that. And one way of doing this is by implanting, for instance, a glaucoma drainage device. You just put in a new pipe, if you will. Well, is that really a good idea? That depends on when you're going to throw out the sink. Are you going to wait until the very end or not? Here you see the unfortunate broken stick problem that we have. In order to avoid progression, glaucoma needs to be treated early and safely. The blue line designates the visual function loss during a patient's life. An early intervention would be desirable because then you can prevent severe visual disability. If you wait until there is already significant vision loss, then this is on a steeper down trajectory, and one would probably have to choose, let's say, a trabeculectomy, an aggressive intervention, but that too cannot necessarily delay things the way you want. This is an interesting example here, how this looks in practice. Here you can see the retinal nerve fiber layer on the x-axis and the visual field. In this case, it's the inferior retinal nerve fiber layer and the superior visual field. And lo and behold, you can lose quite a bit of retinal nerve fiber layer without two terrible things happening. But at one point, there's an inflection point where some patients experience a steep downward slope. This here is at around -5 dB. This doesn't look too bad. There's a little nasal step and some scatter in this visual field. And then, boom, all of a sudden, just with a few micron change, this patient here, this example here, is at -20 dB. So this is a fairly constricted, very disabling visual field. So gotta operate soon. You have to act aggressively, not too late. And look at this. Would you operate, let's say, with a trabeculectomy on a patient who only has a nasal step? Most likely not. Because what we're really treating is quality of life. It's not just IOP. We want a better quality of life with an early diagnosis. We want to detect progression. And then we do that by looking not just at the retinal fiber layer, as I just showed you, but also at the ganglion cell complex, which is super sensitive to pick up early changes. We want to slow down the visual field progression. We want to do that early, maybe initially just by doing a 20% reduction, but one probably needs more, probably around 30%. And if it's late, it has to be very aggressive. We want to simplify treatment. One can do this with a laser that I mentioned, because who likes to take drops? That can reduce the drop intake if this is not done as first line of treatment, and overall improve the compliance, the adherence of the patient to his or her medications. But most importantly, we want to avoid risks. We need a safe algorithm. Laser first, then it's something minimally invasive, and then the big tube shunts where we throw out the sink. So this here is a list of high risk things. So you can certainly just say, well, you know, screw the trabecular meshwork and the distal outflow resistance. I'm going to bypass everything. There are many devices. This is an Ahmed glaucoma drainage device. This is a Preserflow micro shunt that is basically connecting the anterior chamber with a reservoir under the conjunctiva. This is the Zen gel shunt that does the very same thing, although not so reliably. You have to put it in from up interno. One can put it up external in, but that's not so easy to do. It tends to migrate. And then, of course, doing a classical trabeculectomy, that certainly works too. And we were all hoping that one could do this with an even easier approach, sticking a tube into the suprachoroidal space. Note that this device is on the inside, underneath the sclera, while this is an epibulbar approach where we drain the fluid towards the surface of the eye that's then covered just with conjunctiva. This here is on the inside. There was the gold shunt. The graveyard of devices that went into the space is growing. I know Glaukos also had one prepared that was quite similar to the CyPass. The question is, will they actually have the guts to introduce this, given that this device didn't do so well clinically and damaged the endothelium? It turns out this is not a new approach. If you really want to get a pressure of almost zero on this side or zero here, you can also just use a metal prong, a cyclodialysis spatula, stick it in the space, detach the ciliary body, and you have a big cleft. That too creates very low pressures and can be dangerous, because too low of a pressure is dangerous, and then when this closes up again, the pressure jumps quite high. This is an old procedure that's at least 50, if not 80 years old. And all of these things can have consequences that are not so nice. A flat chamber, a leaking bleb, kissing choroidals where fluid accumulates on the inside of the eye and retina eventually starts to touch. Eroding hardware, this is an eroded tube shunt here too. Tube that aspirated vitreous for whatever reason. A blepharitis, this is the infection, this is the risk of having something on the surface of the eye, and then that can move on to become an endophthalmitis, which is quite devastating and basically can kill the eye. And this happens in up to 7% in some long-term studies. It's surprising. We live in denial that it won't happen to us until it does. This is a scleral melt from having used too much mitomycin. Okay, so we as physicians have, we know the Hippocratic Oath, primum non nocere, don't do any harm. So maybe we should do minimally invasive procedures first. Out of 1,000 patients, there were very few serious complications in one of our studies. And when you look at the TVT study, trabeculectomy versus tube study, this is the first one. TRAPS had a lot of early interventions necessary, and they had a lot more early complications. That's basically the take home. The primary TVT study, a newer study, looks a little more favorable for trabeculectomies, but there's no denying that there's a lot of hands on management. So that's the that here is a slide showing you the low risk of enhancing the conventional outflow at the level of the trabecular meshworking. You can put in a scaffold, you can put in stents that bypass the trabecular meshwork. Unfortunately, these two are not very effective. I'm not so sure that there is all that much long-term experience with the hydras, but it gives you a broader access to the to Schlemm's canal. Or one could just disrupt or ablate. This is GATT with a suture threaded through, tearing it through the meshwork to give you good outflow. The same can be done with a device that guides a plastic wire thing that tears this open. The trabectome that's now 17 years old, maybe one of the oldest makes of all. And this is the Trabex, a newer device, which is very similar to the Cahoke dual blade, except that it has irrigation and aspiration. Okay, so well, if this is so nice and lovely, why can't we use these MIGS as a screening test? If we don't have a clinical screening test, is it such a big deal to just give it a try? Well, I think that up to the patient to decide. Having an eye surgery is never a fun thing, even if it's minimally invasive. And there are significant differences between the epinterno and the epibulbar procedures. The trabeculectomy still is king in lowering pressure. These are our data from Würzburg, where we looked at around 200 trabeculectomy patients. They were matched to epinterno trabeculectomy with the trabectal patients. Out of 5,500, we ended up with a very tight, very closely matching patients, and you can see there is a big difference. The trabectum is at around 15 here, and the trabeculectomy ends up being at around 12, so there's a difference. There's also a difference with the surgical success, and this almost looks like somebody confused something here with the color, because the higher pressure, the up and turn trabeculectomy ends up having a higher pressure here, a higher success rate, while the trabeculectomy has a lower success rate. How can this be? Well, we also counted secondary surgeries, and trabeculectomies do need a lot of interventions to make them work. One could use adjuvant distal outflow tract dilation substances, for instance, Rho kinase inhibitors. This shows you how over time the distal outflow tract can be dilated after an intarsidil. The diameter increases, the IOP drops after the trabecular meshwork is removed, so that would be something to consider. One could also use an NO donor. This is again SDOCT showing as red overlay on blue how the vessels have dilated. The vessels of the distal outflow tract have dilated after giving NO. And this is a pressure drop after the meshwork was removed and NO was given. So there is a structure change and a pressure drop that sort of fit together. In summary, we talked about the substrate and the location of outflow resistance. We basically don't know where it is. We only know the trabecular meshwork, but we don't know what generates, in some patients, a very significant resistance downstream of the meshwork. There's no predictive test available to see whether somebody qualifies for an easy surgery that takes literally 3 minutes. That's how long a trabectome surgery takes, versus a trabeculectomy or tube shunt that can be closer to 20, 30 minutes and have considerable risks. Treatment goals have to be to improve the quality of life and reduce the risk. One can argue one should do minimally invasive glaucoma surgeries first for this reason. This certainly is my approach for most patients. Canal-based MIGS seem to be quite benign. Are they benign enough to just give it a try, or do we have to replace the whole sink? And finally, one could try distal outflow tract dilators, their effect is not huge, so one would probably need a well-powered study to pick this up. I got the impression that it works in some patients, but they're also not very powerful drops in patients who have not had trabecular ablation. So I guess that's still an open question. None of this would have been possible without the good lab members I had, and with many collaborators, both local and abroad, and of course, the generous donors and agencies that have supported us. Thank you.